Dear friends, welcome to the discussion on consumer theory. In this session, we include basic elements of consumer theory such as cardinal and ordinal utility, law of diminishing marginal utility, law of equimarginal utility, and more. Please watch the entire video.
In this video, we discuss about consumer behavior. It simply means how a consumer would behave in the market. A consumer gets many products in the market, but all the products do not give him the same level of satisfaction. All of these products are not priced at the same level, so it creates a difficulty for him to choose as to which product he should purchase and which product he should avoid. Theory of consumer behavior is the description of how a consumer allocates income among different goods and services to maximize their well-being. So, the theory of consumer behavior studies how consumers spend their income to attain maximum utility. Utility is the one satisfying power of a commodity. It is the numerical score representing the satisfaction that a consumer gets from a given market basket. There are different types of commodities available in our economy. Each and every commodity has the power to satisfy human wants in some or other ways, which is called utility. In this area, we mainly study two approaches. One is the cardinal utility approach and the other is the ordinal utility approach. Cardinal utility approach is propounded and used by the neoclassical economists like Marshall, Jevons, Walras, Edgeworth, whereas ordinal utility approach is propounded and used by the modern economists like J.R. Hicks and Roy Allen. Cardinal analysis offers a technique to measure utility. They say the amount of money a consumer is willing to pay for a commodity is the utility of the commodity. In cardinal utility approach, utility is measurable and the consumer can express his satisfaction in cardinal or quantitative numbers such as 1, 2, 3 and so on. For instance, if a consumer is willing to pay 20 rupees to consume an apple, then the utility he will get from the apple is 20 units. This method is backed by some assumptions. The first one is rationality. The consumer is rational. He aims at the maximization of his utility subject to the constraint imposed by his given income. The second one is cardinal utility. The utility of each commodity is measurable. Utility is a cardinal concept. The most convenient measure is money. The utility is measured by the monetary units that the consumer is prepared to pay for another unit of the commodity. Third one is constant marginal utility of money. This assumption is necessary if the monetary unit is used as a measure of utility. The essential feature of a standard unit of measurement is that it will be constant. If the marginal utility of money changes as income increases or decreases, the measuring rod for utility becomes like an elastic ruler, inappropriate for measurement. The fourth is diminishing marginal utility. The utility gained from successive units of a commodity diminishes. In other words, the marginal utility of a commodity diminishes as the consumer acquires larger quantities of it. This is the axioms of diminishing marginal utility. And the last one is total utility is additive. The total utility of a basket of goods depends on the quantities of the individual commodities. In very early versions of the theory of consumer behavior, it was assumed that the total utility is additive. The additivity assumption was dropped in later versions of the cardinal utility theory. Additivity implies independent utilities of the various commodities in the bundle, an assumption clearly unrealistic and unnecessary for the cardinal theory. Next, we move for laws of utility analysis. Gossen's law, named after famous economist Hermann Heinrich Gossen. Gossen's first law is the law of diminishing marginal utility. Gossen's second law is the law of equimarginal utility. And the Gossen's third law explains why the marginal utility become positive or negative. First of all, we discuss about the law of diminishing marginal utility. This was proposed by Gossen and it was popularized by Professor Alfred Marshall. So, this is a very important law. It has got wide application. As long as we study and apply the concepts of economics, there is no escaping from the law of diminishing marginal utility. As consumers consume more and more units of a specific commodity, utility from the successive unit goes on diminishing. According to Marshall, the additional benefit a person derives from a given increase of his stock of a thing diminishes with every increase in the stock that he already has. The benefit means utility or satisfaction. If he goes on increasing the consumption, the benefit diminishes with every increase. As he goes on increase in the consumption, the satisfaction level that you derive from the next consumption, it was on diminishing. Let's say you are having ice creams. The first ice cream that you have will give you the maximum amount of satisfaction. Now, when you have the second ice cream, it is obvious that you will derive lesser satisfaction from it. Because when you consume the first ice cream, you did not have any ice cream before it. You want a desire to have an ice cream. So, with the consumption of first ice cream, that desire is satisfied. So, you derive the maximum level of satisfaction. But when you have the second unit, the second ice cream, you again derive some level of utility. But it is not equal or more than the first. It will always be less than the satisfaction derived from first ice cream because you already had the ice cream. Now you do not have that intends to have another ice cream, but you also have third ice cream. Now, what will happen is in the third consumption, the satisfaction that you get will decrease furthermore. As you go on having more and more ice cream, the extra benefit or additional benefit you derive from each consumption will go on diminishing or reducing. This law is based on some assumptions. They are the following. All the utility is measurable in cardinal form. A rational consumer aims at the maximization of his utility. Standard units of measurement is constant. The commodity is consumed continuously. Proper units of goods are consumed by the consumer. Units are homogeneous in nature. Taste of the consumer remains the same. Income of the consumer is constant and the commodity is divisible. Now we have moved to the diagrammatic explanation of law of diminishing marginal utility. On the x-axis, we represent the commodity consumed, and on the y-axis, we represent the total utility and marginal utility. When we move away from the origin on the both the axis, the value increases. Instead, if I move on right of x-axis, it means I am consuming higher number of x units. When move upward on the y-axis, the total utility and marginal utility also change. When we start consuming given commodity, the utility increases and it reaches maximum, and later it decreases. But what happening to marginal utility? The marginal utility is reducing and intersect with the x-axis also. At the point of intersection, the value of marginal utility is equal to zero. It wouldn't stop there. It goes below the x-axis. It means that its value also becoming negative. There is one very interesting observation that is done here. When total utility is maximum, marginal utility is zero. When total utility starts to decline, marginal utility becomes negative. Next, we move to law of equimarginal utility. This law is different from law of diminishing marginal utility, because in this law, now we are bringing in a second commodity, not instead only one commodity at a time. In this law, we learn how a consumer allocates his income to all the commodities he has to consume. So in this law, there will be many commodities that we study. However, generally we take two commodities. In order to get maximum satisfaction, a consumer should spend his limited income on different commodities in such a way that the last rupee spent on each commodity yield him equal marginal utility. Now, this law is different from past law, that is law of demand and law of diminishing marginal utility, in the sense that in demand we had price as a variable. In law of diminishing marginal utility, we did not have price as a variable, but we had the marginal utility there. In this law, we blend both the laws, that is the law of demand and law of diminishing marginal utility, and see how a consumer spend his income to maximize the satisfaction level from 2, 3 or any number of commodities that he consumes. The important factor to know here is the marginal utility. The marginal utility from all the commodities should be equal. So when you are consuming one commodity, you may derive some utility from it. When you consume the second unit of that commodity, you still derive utility from it. And when you go on consuming many units of that commodity, you still tend to get utility from it. Though the marginal utility decreases, the total utility goes on increasing. Likewise, when you consume the second commodity, you again derive some utility from it. Now, this law relates to equating the utility from both the commodities the consumer should consume, or the other consumer should spend his income on both the commodities in such a way that the utility derived from both the commodities is equal. There are two statements of law. One is traditional statement and the other is modern statement. The traditional statement discuss about the consumer will spend his money income in such a way that last rupee spent on each commodity will give him equal satisfaction. That is, marginal utility from first commodity is equal to marginal utility from second commodity is equal to etc. equal to marginal utility from nth commodity. There are some conditions for this statement. There must be two or more commodities. Whatever the marginal utility he get from both commodities must be equal. He must spend all the income. The modern statement also called the law of proportionality. When marginal utility of one commodity divided by its price and the marginal utility of other commodity divided by its price are equal, that is, marginal utility of A divided by price of A is equal to marginal utility of B divided by price of B is equal to marginal utility of C divided by price of C. Then we have to move on diagrammatic explanation. The x-axis represent the unit of commodity consumed and the y-axis represent the marginal utility of x and y. Here, 5 units of x provides marginal utility of 12 and 3 units of y provides marginal utility of 12. No other unit equalizes the utility of two goods in such a way that last rupee spent on each good yield the same marginal utility. Here, equilibrium is a position where our allocation on different goods stop. If there is no equal marginal utility, we reallocate expenditure on different goods. The last but not the least is Gosson's third law. It explains why the marginal utility become positive or negative. Scarcity create positive marginal utility. In the case of scarcity, marginal utility never falls to zero. Plenty causes marginal utility falls to zero and then negative. Goods have value only when the demand for it exceeds supply. Scarcity is a precondition for economic value. Since the marginal utility of a good decreases with its stock, it has positive marginal utility so long as its supply falls short of demand. In case the supply is able to satisfy the want fully, marginal utility of it will falls to zero. So let me conclude my words. Thanks for watching.
Thanks for watching the video. Please do subscribe, share, and comment.